Rika is Marnas Kulkarni, and he's talking about the non-Hermitian quantum system as a quantum device.
Thanks. So first of all, I would like to thank all the other organizers and especially the ICTS program office, who did a fantastic job. So today I'm going to speak about non-Hermitian systems as quantum devices. So I'll try to explain what I mean by that. So before I jump into the topic, part of my research interest is on driven quantum systems, and I have been looking at a couple of examples of driven quantum systems. So I'm just going to sketch out some examples of driven quantum systems. One example is when you have mesoscopic systems, like the one Aditi was giving an example, quantum dots at finite voltage bias, but then if you couple them to additional bosonic degrees of freedom, like photons or phonons, you can have some interesting phenomena, and it can lead to quantum devices. You can study Kondo effect with light, etc., etc. So this is one set of systems which I am very interested in. And the other kind of driven quantum systems are co-atomic gases, namely something like a BEC, the conventional BEC, but now coupled to photons. And there you can study some interesting open quantum phase transitions, non-Hermitian matrices, and so on. And the third kind of direction which I'm interested in is something called quantum Hamiltonian and bath engineering. This is very much related to the pedagogical lectures by Michael Hartridge, where he tried to show how you can generate various kind of Hamiltonians, not only Hamiltonians, also your reservoirs. So you can sort of engineer your non-hermeticity to various sort of things. And you can study entangled states, some open versions of condensed matter systems, like you can get spin chains, but now open spin chains. And you can study various time dynamics, transport, and steady states. So just pictorial representation of these three things is in the next slide. So this is one such schematic where you have these quantum dots at finite voltage bias. If you just look at the thing inside, this is essentially what Aditi was talking about. She had just one quantum dot, but just think of two quantum dot at finite voltage bias. But now you are in a cavity. So the question is what kind of physics that you can get by integrating these traditional mesoscopic systems with photons. The other schematic is here, where you have a BEC in a cavity, and these are sort of the sample experimental groups whom we sort of discuss a lot with. So kind of experiments are happening widely in Petta's group, and Takis Kontos' group, who was here last week, and Petta was here last year, as some of you might remember. And these kind of experiments are cold atoms in cavities, and they have each of these open quantum systems touch upon various different interesting phenomena, both from fundamental point of view and from the point of view of some applications. And this is the third kind of system, an actual device in Irfan Siddiqui's lab, where you sort of engineer these light matter systems. You can sort of generate chiral currents in some engineered light matter systems. And these are the groups which sort of do this. The techniques that we commonly use are Kramatic Keldysh techniques, Lindblad equation, Redfield, some brute force methods, quantum Langevin, depending on the problem that we are interested in. So to sort of organize the things, so these kind of light systems, of course, the whole thing is Hermitian, but you're often interested in a part of it, and hence you get your non-Hermitian system. And they are very useful in studying fundamental concepts like entanglement, transport, correlations. And they sort of naturally help us realize certain non-Hermitian matrices, which you can study, open version of phase transition, statistics of bosons. So what happens to bosonic statistics when the system is out of equilibrium? How different it is from thermal distribution and so on? So this is sort of from fundamental point of view. And these kind of systems are also useful in terms of realizing quantum like rectifiers, transistors, photonic amplifiers, and masers, which are lasers in the microwave regime. So in this talk, I'm going to sort of focus on this part here about how certain quantum dot setups can be used in realizing rectifiers, for example. So rectification means you sort of try to send a current in one direction, but from the other direction, you can't send the same kind of current. Okay, so it is like non-reciprocity. And so somehow you can transpose signal in one direction, but if you're doing it in the opposite direction, it gets blocked or just partially transmits. So, and the underlying reason is interaction. So if you have a non-interactive system, typically the rectification is zero. Okay, so I'll focus on this. So my talk is going to be based on two parts. One is I'm going to talk about how such systems can serve as microwave amplifiers and masers. This is in collaboration with BJ at Department of Physics in ICER Pune and Divira Siegel at Chemical Physics Theory Group and Center for Quantum Information and Control at University of Toronto. The other part is, this is sort of you can think of it as quantum devices from the perspective of photonic properties. So the question is, can I make a device where I can get amplification of my signal? So that is a microwave amplifier. And can I make a device which acts like a very good laser? So that is in these particular quantum dot circuit QED systems. And why quantum dot circuit QED systems are very special, I will try to say when I proceed in my talk. Here I'll try to argue that similar quantum dot circuit QED systems are good diodes, rectifiers, and transistors. So this is sort of, you can think of this as electronic quantum devices. Okay, so part one will focus on photonic properties, and part two will focus on electronic properties. So so that is the plan. These are some old papers, so none of this is actually published. So it's not even on archive. So hopefully, in some reasonable time scales, it should appear on archive. But these are some older papers where I have been interested in this kind of quantum devices, and we have benefited. We keep benefiting a lot from Jason Petta, Tokis Kontos, Dickey, and so on and so forth in terms of trying to understand these systems. Okay, so part one. So all you need to remember is this diagram. Okay. This diagram is, this is the left lead, this is the right lead, different chemical potentials, two quantum dots. So you can have electronic transport, okay? You can have current through the quantum dots, but they're also coupled to photons, okay? So the natural question to ask is, if I run an electronic current, what is the impact on the photonic part of the system, right? So that is the first question to ask. If I don't have this whole dot itself, and if I just have cavity photon, then the distribution is, it'll get some temperature from the environment and the distribution is thermal. But now the question is, what kind of distributions will this photonic part take because of this electronic system? So you can think of this electronic system as some sort of a gain medium or a loss medium. Okay? So this G is light matter interaction. We'll step by step, we will build the Hamiltonian. So, but you can think of these arrows as you send some input, you get some output, and you do output over input, and does it amplify? So approximately, Ashish Clerk, I think, sort of briefly talked about this. So that tells you how much you get amplified, okay? Just because of the quantum dot setup inside, okay? Okay, so why are we interested in this? So, as some of you know, just a few years earlier, there was some news where one managed to show that if you have these kind of quantum dots as some units, it can help you get a laser in a microwave regime. So just because of this quantum transport, electronic quantum transport, you manage to make a laser. So this was the news when they said rice grain laser, because these are just, I will show you the system and then it will become clear. And they used a two double quantum dot units. Okay, but later, just recently, they put out a paper where they managed to do it one double quantum dot unit. You can imagine why. If you have more units, better gain. So you need some sort of a pump, right? So that is the idea. Any questions? No. Okay. So going back to this diagram here, think of this as the gain medium, and this whole thing as the double quantum dot circuit QED setup. Okay, so now question is, what are the kind of things they measure? Okay, so many of these experimental setups, you just create a finite DC bias, and you let current run through it. And that's going on. It's a DC current, simple experiment. And then you ask yourself, what is the gain in the photonic sector? Okay. And you notice that there is enormous gain here. And you see that there is a gain as a function of EL. EL is just the, you can think of it as the level of the quantum dot. So these are the kind of tunability you have in these systems. If you just have an ordinary atom, it's hard to tune these levels. So here you can sort of change the level of the quantum dots. So your parameter space is widely tunable, as I will try to show you further. And then you can measure something called emission spectrum. Some quantity like this, which happens to be related to the Keldysh-Green's function. So basically, you can, not necessary. There can be shifts. I'll show you some diagrams where
quasi-resonant then.
Right. So, I mean, it's a bit more complicated because you have all these different non-equilibrium bars, so things get shifted. You'll see some figures, yeah. Absolutely. So there could be a loss, and you can imagine one kind of thing is that if you are sitting here, there's a loss, right? That means if my quantum dots are at some non-favorable level, then it's lossy. Okay, so, and you can show some results where you can find a parameter space where there's gain and loss. You'll see. So yeah, you can have loss, but that's not. You tend to have want gain. So this thing things like this, but this I will not touch. You can measure something called not only the output over input, but output over input is like a complex number. So not only the amplitude, but also the phase. And so on and so forth. So, in addition to that, you can measure the photonic statistics. And you see, on one hand, you can have photonic statistics, which is just thermal, some temperature, or maybe some mild effective temperature. Okay? You can have just thermal distribution. Or you can have Poissonian distribution, if it's in the lasing regime. Okay? So, this fellow here is sort of caused by your quantum dot element, okay? Your current is running in such a way, in such a parameter space, that the photonic sector has a Poissonian distribution, okay? And those who have sat for Michael's talk know that there is an IQ curve where this blob will represent that it's just thermal state, and this blob actually represents that it's a Poissonian corresponds to a Poissonian distribution, and this is the same diagram but for a recent paper. So the take-home message is you can measure photonic statistics. No mazing means thermal. Mazing means Poissonian. Okay? And these happen to be at the microwave regime. Okay? So your frequencies are gigahertz. And that's why it's called a maser. Okay? Laser in a microwave regime. Okay. So now let us build this step by step. So your Hamiltonian is matter plus cavity. Plus matter cavity, and your matter itself is double quantum dot lead, double quantum dot phonon. Okay, so and your double quantum dot is just by this Hamiltonian. So the experiments are in such a regime where you can either have one electron in the left quantum dot, it's a double quantum dot, okay? You can have one electron in the left quantum dot or one electron in the right quantum dot. Having one electron in each quantum dot is sort of forbidden because it's very high energy. Okay, so you can have 1, 0, 0, 1. So that is what makes a charge qubit. They call it a charge qubit. When you want to talk about transport, you can also have 0, 0. So you can have 0, 0, 1, 0, 0, 1. Okay, so that is basically this. And then, Aditya has already explained what dot lead coupling means. Dot phonon coupling is the same kind of thing where the dot is coupled to, where this quantum dot is coupled to the phonons. Okay, an additional bunch of harmonic oscillators. And the cavity itself is this A dagger A, just harmonic oscillator. And the harmonic oscillator is also coupled to a bunch of phonons, a bunch of bosons. Okay, that accounts for the leakiness of the cavity. Okay, and then you have this DQD cavity interaction. This is the main thing. This is light matter interaction. Tau Z is the matter, and A plus A dagger is the cavity photon. So G is the light matter interaction. Okay, so this is the Hamiltonian structure. Sorry. G is about 50 megahertz, 50 to 80 megahertz, and maybe 100 if you push. And omega C is like 5 to 6 gigahertz. Okay, so this is still, G is still small compared to omega cavity. So it's still, you can still treat things perturbatively in G. Okay? Okay, it looks like I am going to badly run out of time because I will just try to accelerate, then I'll decelerate later. So here is the same story where you sort of write it in some eigenstates and you finally have this part. So you have a unitary part and then you have a non-Hermitian part, and the non-Hermitian part is coming from three kind of baths. So one is the phonon bath, because the double quantum dot is embedded in the substrate, or it will be in a nanowire which has phonons. So one is a phonon bath. Another is a cavity bath. These cavities are leaky. Okay, so the cavity also should be mimicked by the cavity coupled to a bath. So this is cavity bath, and this is the electronic bath. The leads, okay? The leads are electronic. So the leads are also a bath. So you can think of this as a unitary part plus a non-Hermitian part. Okay? Okay, so this is the structure of the non-Hermitian part. So let me skip these things a bit. But basically, you can see that different things have different structures. The electronic bath also helps in pumping the system. The cavity bath sort of serves as a leakiness, and then phonon bath also has several different contributions. Phonon bath can, in principle, serve as a pump or a damping term or a dephasing term. Okay, so these baths can change the structure of your system in many complicated ways. Okay, but essentially these are sort of these are the non-unitary pieces. Okay, so the Hamiltonian, the unitary part is just my what I'm interested in, namely the double dot and my cavity mode. Okay, that is what I will call my subsystem. The rest I will treat as bath, which I can do because they have large degrees of freedom. Okay, so that is my system plus bath. Okay, so now before I study statistics, one can calculate certain quantities of interest. So you can write. Please notice this notation. This is dE dagger dG. E and G are in the eigenbasis of the quantum dot. So this is these are different elements of the density matrix. Okay. And you can write some reduced density matrix equations for the dots and the photons. And there's one thing that we add this coherent drive. Okay, this coherent drive is just a classical drive which serves like an input. Okay, and all I'm interested in is expectation value of A divided by E. Okay, that's all I'm interested in. So this E cosine omega T is just, you can add it in the Hamiltonian and just finally calculate expectation of value of A divided by E. Okay, and the absolute value of square of this is called transmission, and the phase is called the phase response. Okay, these are the two things they measure in the experiment. Okay, so it's just a linear response experiment. I send a small coherent drive, and I see how my output signal is. I take output divided by input with some factors, and I get the gain and loss and so on. Okay, so you can finally show that this fellow takes this form. Okay, which is sort of expected, because if I didn't have my quantum dot system at all, then I would just get this piece here. I would not get this chi here. Okay, and this is just a nice Lorentzian with some width kappa, which has peak at omega cavity expected, right? So your transmission without the quantum dot, if you calculate absolute value of T square at omega equal to, at for any omega as a function of omega, you will see something like this. This will be peaked at omega cavity, and this is kappa. Now the question is, what is this quantum dot, this driven, intensely driven quantum dot doing to this quantity? And all that information goes into chi. Okay? And information like bias voltage, temperature, coupling between double quantum dot and the leads, coupling between double quantum dot and the phononic bath, everything goes into that. Okay, it's a very lengthy expression, but technically you can sort of in some compact form write it like this. But the story is, if this chi electron, you can write it as chi is equal to chi prime plus I chi double prime, and if I manage to get if I just the sign of chi double prime will tell me if I get a gain or a loss. That's all. So the question is, if I can tune the parameters of my system and show that I can switch the sign of chi double prime, I'm sort of done. Okay, and this chi prime will just shift the frequency a bit. This is probably Duncan's question, but okay, we can okay. So. Okay, so now this is the transmission function of drive. This is what I was drawing on the board. Phase response is just the phase of that quantity, which also people can measure experimentally. So we usually have it side by side. But the important point here is, as you see, it is not entirely clear where one has to sit in this huge parameter space. Okay, sometimes increasing G can help, sometimes increasing delta mu can help. So there are interesting regimes where you get gain. Anything more than one is gain, okay? Anything less than one is loss. Okay, so this is the diagram. So for example, I can give you a simple example. The red one is when there is no interaction between the quantum dot and the light at all. Okay, so that is why it is peaked at one. The black one when there is interaction, but there is delta mu and also it's not entirely clear that just having just turning on G is enough. You have to make sure that the system is such that it is pumping in a way that I can switch the sign of this imaginary part. Okay, and that will give me some threshold condition and so on. But let me skip that. Where is Rho GG? Rho GG is the occupation of the ground state. Okay, so thanks for asking this, because Rho EE minus Rho GG is basically population inversion. Okay, so basically that is the thing. Okay, so essentially you are trying to create a population inversion, and that will eventually help me flip this sign, and that will eventually give me gain. Okay, so Any other questions? Okay. Okay, so this is basically the transmission at a fixed omega cavity. So typically, you just try to calculate this at omega equal to omega cavity. Because my drive, I can choose the frequency of my drive. But then I swipe something else. I swipe epsilon. Epsilon here, so we'll come to Aditi's previous question. So epsilon here is the energy level difference between the double quantum dots. So notice that when epsilon is positive, I have gain, okay? Which means that my system is approximately like this. My system is approximately like this. Epsilon being positive means I have this kind of situation, okay? E1 minus E2. So I have gain, which is sort of expected you have this kind of thing. But if I have negative, this is what I have. The bias is still here, the same. And so you have loss. So you can sort of understand some of these things, not all, just by these kind of arguments. Okay, so an epsilon is something that they can change experimentally very easily. In fact, all these things are taken from experimental numbers, so they can change this from minus 200 mu EV to 200 mu EV and so on. And then you can find very sweet spots where you can get high transmission in omega and epsilon. Notice that sitting on omega equal to omega C may not be the best because the thing also shifts, right? So I said that you can even shift because of the real part of chi prime. So if I sit at omega cavity, I may not get the best deal. So I have to, you know, choose my, try to span this space and see where I can get the best this thing. So this shift is actually important. I mean, it is not negligible. So this is how, so let's forget transmission. Let's look at only, so I have 8 minutes. Okay. So let's forget transmission and let's look at only the imaginary part. Just the imaginary part, okay? Notice that my imaginary part is always negative, which is not good, okay? But when I change my bias, suddenly my imaginary part becomes positive. And when my imaginary part becomes positive, this will compete with my kappa and give me gain, okay? So these are very different ways of looking at the same figure, but let me accelerate now to photonic statistics. So this is with questions or without questions? Without, okay. Yes, exactly. Okay, so now, till now, we sort of studied this kind of amplification. You send some signal and see how it is amplified. But now let me ask you, what is the statistics of photons? What is rho n versus, okay? If I just have a cavity coupled to its path, then rho n will just be a thermal distribution with temperature of the environment. So it turns out that we can calculate this quantity. Okay, finally you'll get something like this. This is the equation for the probability of rows, okay? Only the photonic part, okay? Only the photonic part. And then below a certain threshold, you can show that rho is just thermal with some effective temperature. Okay, and the effective temperature basically is given by this. So you can show that if you remove light matter interaction, it will become temperature of its path and so on. So this is just an effective temperature, and rho is just thermal. Okay, above a certain threshold. Okay, so then eventually for all other regimes, you get some form, and then you can show that it becomes Poissonian. So let me just show you the diagram here. So what I'm trying to say here is, this is rho n versus n, okay? So this is rho n versus n. And notice that I tried how I can change the statistics of photons inside my cavity. So here you see that just by changing kappa, I change the statistics. Here I change g. So Aditi asked me that what is G? So G is typically 50 megahertz, but you can increase G in the experiment up to 100. If I keep everything else fixed, just by increasing G, I can change this thermal to Poissonian. this is the signature of a laser. Okay, so here I just change delta mu, which is one a very easy thing to do in the experiment. I just increase the voltage bias, the DC bias, and just by doing that, I change from thermal to Poissonian. So to get just gain, amplification is easier, but to get lasing is much harder because you have to pass the threshold and then the statistics itself changes. Okay? And here you can see that just by changing epsilon, I change it from thermal to Poissonian. A very easy thing to do in experiment. So if I have epsilon is 10, all I'm saying is make my epsilon 20, meaning they have these gate voltages in the experiment. Let me call it VG1 and VG2. Just increase this gate voltage. And they just raise this level a bit, then make epsilon 20, and the statistics inside, and then the system just starts lazing. Okay, so the thing is that it's very hard to do this kind of tuning and so on and so forth in conventional lasers. So that is what I was trying to say. Okay, so this is basically the experiment on a double quantum dot, but the same experiment was done with a single double quantum dot, and that is the story with statistics. So we can also compute some other quantities which to show more and more that we are agreeing with the so-called definitions of what exactly it means to have a laser. Anyway, so in the last few minutes, I'll just go to part B. So till now, I only spoke about photonic properties. I never said anything about electronic current. Although I was saying that there is current, I never cared about what this current is doing and what is its this thing. So now I'm going to completely switch gears and just focus on current and ask myself, can I use this kind of light-matter interaction to make a rectifier? Okay? Can I have a situation where I have my voltage and then I'm running my current? Okay? And let me call this I1. Okay? And now all I want to do is just switch my bias. Just switch my voltage bias, make it opposite, and then run a current like this, and make sure that I1 is not equal to I2. Okay? This is rectifier. Okay? Which means that in one direction it is flowing, in the other direction it is not flowing in the same way. And the ingredient is interactions and so on. So we'll try to argue that these new quantum dot circuit QD systems are also pretty good rectifiers and also transistors. So this is in collaboration with a group in China from Suzhou University and Key Lab of Modern Technologies in Education Ministry of China and with Jirin at Center for Phononics and Thermal Energy Sciences in Tongji. So this. This system is more or less the same, but now we have made slight modification. We have made this quantum dots non-interacting. Okay, meaning that before they were quantum dots where one was sort of forbidden. So in some sense, it was like really interacting because it was a large inter-Coulomb interaction. Right here is like just like non-interacting quantum dots. Just one more quantum dot to Aditi's diagram, and then coupled to photonic mode. But then we try to calculate this quantity non-perturbatively in G, non-perturbatively in light matter interaction. Okay. So my previous calculations were okay. So let me. So both these calculations, my previous and this, is sort of perturbative in dot lead coupling. Okay, it's perturbative in dot lead coupling. So that is this thing. So basically, what we do here is we sort of have. So let me not go through this system. The only important thing to remember is we are going to treat this quantum dot and this cavity mode as one unit, and we are going to call it polaron or whatever you want. And we are going to evaluate the polaron Green's function non-perturbatively in G, okay, and then use that to calculate currents, okay. So So basically the expression of currents is this, but what is important is to calculate these Green's functions. Okay, so treat the Green's functions non-perturbatively. After that, follow the standard procedure of connecting system to lead, and that is weak in system bath coupling. Okay? So it turns out that the non-perturbative hybridized dot Green's function is given by some expression, which is actually non-perturbative in G. And then you can similarly calculate the Keldysh part, and then calculate the currents. And basically, this is the expression that you get for currents. So basically, you see, this is how I would define rectification, charge rectification and cross rectification. So you can see that the current is going like this, but then it is not really exactly anti-symmetric. Okay? If it is perfectly anti-symmetric, then the rectification is zero. If it is perfectly anti-symmetric, then this will be this. This will be equal to this. Okay? But if it is, and so it is not perfectly anti-symmetric, and the question is, can I push the experiment so far that somehow my current gets totally suppressed if I try to run it in the other direction? So that will be having like almost 100% rectification. Okay? So, but here we see we get about 40%, 50% rectifications and so on. Gamma left and gamma right are, no, they are different. They are different, yeah. No, so if gamma left and gamma right are different, but if you don't have interactions, then rectification is zero. So just having a symmetric system is not sufficient. So just having an asymmetric system is not sufficient. You need asymmetry and interactions. So that is the thing, yeah. So the, okay, so it is a bit counterintuitive because if you have non-interacting quantum dots at finite voltage bias and have asymmetric coupling, if you actually calculate the rectification, it will be zero. Although the thing will look asymmetric. Yeah. Okay, so you can also find, we also notice some transistor effects. Let me skip this thing. So the conclusions are that these are good microwave amplifiers, photon sources and masers, and tuning parameters can help change photonic statistics, and scalability and exotic many-body phenomena is quite an open problem in these systems. And question is, how do you do non-perturbative in system lead coupling? Still not very clear because we just have so many degrees of freedom. And part B, we showed that they are good rectifiers and transistors. And transistor effect can exist in linear regime. Basically, it's a non-reciprocal device. And I'll leave these. So outlook is that in principle, it will be good to add Coulomb energy, do non-perturbative system lead coupling, spin rectification effects is another interesting question. What happens to chain of quantum dots is a very interesting question. So what happens if you have a chain of quantum dots? You sort of make a longer system, and then you couple it to bath. So this kind of system is already just realized in Princeton with 9 dots, but no cavity yet. So it's a chain of 9 dots at finite voltage bias. So in principle, Jason says that he would like to also connect it to cavities. So that's a large system. So it's a many system in real sense. So yeah, thank you.
Thank you very much. Any question, comments?
Yeah, wonderful exposition, of course. But I'm just wondering, you know, you had light amplification. Yes, of course. But what about the phase coherence and all other attributes of laser is covered by photon statistics in some way? I mean, lasing would mean also coherence in the, just radiance or, okay.
Right. So one part was just amplification, and that you can have even below lasing. Another is the lasing. So question is, what all do you need to do to call it a laser, right? So this is actually not very clear to us. So one is that you should get an IQ characteristic like this. So one should get Poissonian distribution, and that is one thing. Another thing is there's something here where. Something here where some width of the emission spectrum, if it's at the order of kilohertz, that's basically sort of criteria for having laser. But the statistics, getting the statistics, is a very strong evidence of having a laser.
Do you have a kind of a simple picture of how does the interaction bring the non-reciprocity in your system? How do I see it?
That is a bit hard to say. I mean, I have some hidden slide for that. Not for that, but actually no, it's not. Once again, sorry. So this quantity, it's hard to have an intuitive explanation, I don't have a very intuitive explanation of why you get rectification. I mean, the question is, if I have some asymmetry in the problem, say gamma L is not gamma R, if I'm given this, then is any interaction sufficient to give rectification? And I'm not sure, because if you see our rectification plots, there are regions where the rectification is actually zero, okay, even though you have interactions. So it's a very complicated, I think, process. It's not very clear. So if you see this plot here, EL and ER are the levels of the dot, and this is for G is 0.05, you have interaction. But if I sit here, there's no rectification. So yeah, it's hard. Even classical systems, to explain non-reciprocity in classical systems also, I'm not very sure how to physically explain that. Yeah.
Okay. And it's not a very broadband phenomenon then, because it's not really broadband. The non-reciprocity occurs only in some narrow bands of frequency. Or?
No, not necessary. So you see here, there's a big red spot here with almost 35% rectification. Okay, so I think there are regions even here, you see. They're pretty good regions. And this is EL and ER, so experimentally you can really sit there. This is extremely accessible. And measuring current is something also easy in experiment. And changing the voltage bias is also easy. So we hope somebody does this experiment. So.
So if not, let's thank the speaker again.